Good morning. Welcome to St. Luke's. Welcome home. I'm Pastor Luca Taliano, and today we are on part two. Last week, we saw the theme, repent or perish, as God calls out to us, turn, turn from your sins. But today we see the flip side of that, that God welcomes those who repent. Our opening hymn, you'll see as an insert in your bulletin if you like following along with the music. Otherwise, of course, the words will be up on the screen. This is a hymn that expresses that repentance and the confidence that God himself greets us. Let's begin with hymn 738, In Hopelessness and Near Despair. Let's praise the Lord.
Hear a story that will be familiar to many of you, the story of the prodigal son. Our gospel is from Luke chapter 15. Now, the tax collectors and the sinners were all gathered around to hear Jesus. But the Pharisees and the teachers of the law muttered, this man welcomes sinners and eats with them. Then Jesus told them this parable. There was a man that had two sons. The younger one said to his father, Father, give me my share of the estate. So he divided up his property between them. Not long after that, the younger son got together all he had, set off for a distant country, and there squandered his wealth in wild living. After he'd spent everything, there was a severe famine in that whole country, and he began to be in need. So he went and hired himself out a citizen of that country who sent him out to his fields to feed pigs. He longed to fill his stomach with the pods that the pigs were eating and don't get anything. When he came to his senses, he said, how many of my father's hired men have food to spare? Here I am starving to death. I'll set out and go back to my father and say to him, Father, I have sinned against heaven and against you. I am no longer worthy to be called your son. Make me like one of your hired men. So he got up and went to his father. But while he was still a long way off, his father saw him and was filled with compassion for him. He ran to his son, threw his arms around him, and kissed him. The son said to him, Father, I have sinned against heaven and against you. I'm no longer worthy to be called your son. But the father said to his servants, quick, bring the best robe and put it on him. Put a ring on his finger and sandals on his feet. Bring the fattened calf and kill it. Let's have a feast and celebrate. For the son of mine was dead and he's alive again. He was lost and is found. So they began to celebrate. Meanwhile, the older son was in the field. When he came near the house, he heard music and dancing. So he called one of the servants and asked him what was going on. Your brother has come, he replied, and your father has killed the fattened calf because he hasn't died safe and sound. The older brother became angry and refused to go in. So his father went out and pleaded with him, but he answered his father, look, all these years I've been slaving for you and never disobeyed your orders. Yet you never even gave me a young goat so I could celebrate with my friends. But when this son of yours, who has squandered your property with prostitutes, comes home, you kill the fat calf for him? My son, the father said, you are always with me, and everything I have is yours. But we had to celebrate and be glad because this brother of yours was dead and is alive again. He was lost and is found. This is God's gospel. The stench of pig urine fills his days. And when you spend time around filth like that, it soaks in your clothing, it soaks in your skin, and it follows you wherever you go. You can't get rid of it. You can't shower it off. He trudges out again with a bucket full of carob pods. It's his job to feed the pigs. So he goes back and forth every day. The pigs squeal as he approaches and he tosses the bucket's contents toward them. And as those pods fly through the air, his jaw yawns open and he reaches after them. He's so hungry that even these pods look good. Carob is terrible anyways. It tastes like mush. But the farmer's already actually emptied the pods, and all that's left is the husk. It's like you've taken the peas out of the husk, and that's all that's left. And that's what he's hungry for. That's what he's starving for. But he closes his hand, draws it back. No. This is what I deserve. This is what I've earned. I wasted it all. I was reckless with the money. I didn't keep what I should have done. I wasted my money. No. Man up. Admit it. It's not my money I wasted. It's my dad's. I didn't wait for him to die. I went up and said, "Dad, I can't wait for you to die. Just give me the money now." He gave me the money. What is wrong with him that he would give a dope like me that much? What is wrong with him?
Yeah.
give him the money. Is Dad still angry? If I could give 50 cents out of every dollar to someone and they wasted it, I'd be angry. Is Dad still angry? And as he continues his plodding course home, he looks up and he sees it's Dad. He's running towards him. And why should he be surprised that Father would see him coming and demand, "No, you can't even come on my property. You stay away." He's coming to try and push me away. And the man falls to the dirt road, his face grinding into the mud. And he calls out at the top of his lungs, trying to call out over the sound of his beating heart, "Father, I've sinned against heaven and against you. I'm no longer worthy to be called your son." And at that moment, he's smothered. But he's not smothered by his father trying to kill him. In his filth and his stench, Father has embraced him. And Dad is weeping. He is weeping tears of joy, and he is laughing. And they stand there in the fields, weeping together, reunited. Dad stands back and looks at his son, and he calls out to the servants, "Quick! What are you wearing, son? Quick, bring the best clothes! My son will have new clothes. No, I'm giving them to you. You cannot pay for them. I'm giving them to you, son. Bring the good clothes and bring the checkbook. He needs access to our funds again. Bring the checkbook. He gets it again. And, oh, what are you wearing on your feet? Can't walk around like that. Bring the good sandals and yes, the good insert so that his feet are comfortable. Bring the veal. Pull the veal out, throw it on the grill. And good wine. Not that cheap stuff. Bring out the good wine. Because the son of mine, he was dead. And he is alive. He was lost. And look, I found him." Beloved, you are the prodigal. This is your story. I don't know where the story you are. I have no clue. Maybe you're looking at what God commands you. You say, "No, there's something better over there. I don't want to listen to what God says." And you're longing to go elsewhere. Maybe you are taking what God has given you and you've used it as an excuse to go into sin and say, "God forgives me, I come to church, I can ignore this one little thing." Maybe you finally have been awakened to the stench of your sin and you see it for the filth that it is. And you don't think that your father could ever accept you back and you want to buy your way back. But I pray that you're at the end of this story. That you come to your father saying, I don't deserve this. And that you hear your God laugh, but not laughing at you, but laughing for joy that you have returned. Laughing for joy and embracing you in all of your filth and saying, "You are my child and you cannot buy your way back. You cannot purchase my love. I give it to you. It is yours. I want you to have this." And that you fall into your father's arms weeping. And you are whole. Become prodigal again. There's the older brother. When Jesus told the story, there were two sons. There was the younger son who ran off. And then there's the older brother. Can you imagine being him? Your little brother is such a punk that he asks your dad for all his stuff. And then when he goes, what do you think? Good riddance! Get out of here! Me? I'm going to work hard for dad. Only half of his stuff is left, but you know what? I'm going to work hard. I'm going to make him not even miss the other son. I'm going to work so hard. I'm going to earn his love. I'm going to make dad proud of me. And he slaves away from his father. There is no joy in his slave. There is only work. And he works so hard for years, toiling away. And then years later, it's been a long day of work. The head is red from the sun, drenched in sweat, dirt under the fingernails in every crevice. And he trudges home and he hears, is that a DJ? Did Dad get, what is going on here? They lit all the torches. That's a lot of money. That's my inheritance. He's wasting my money. What is going on? What is wrong with my father? Calls one of the servants over. What's going on? And the servant answers, your brother's back. Dad had to celebrate because he's back and he's healthy. What? That welfare slob is back? That lazy trash is back? That thief? And this is what Dad does? I'm gonna celebrate this. No way! An older brother pouts outside. And he's conspicuous in his absence. And Dad comes outside. Son, come in, celebrate with us. And older brother goes, why? Why should I? I have slaved away for you for years. I have never taken a day off. And what do? You don't even give me a goat to party with my pals. But when this son of yours shows up, oh, I get it. He takes after you, huh? He was irresponsible with money, now I see what you're doing. This is your son, huh? I will not celebrate this. And the father answers, son, I have always loved you. And everything I have is yours. You didn't have to work to get my love, and you didn't have to work to get my permission to celebrate. Everything I have is yours. But how could I keep from celebrating when your brother came back? Not just my son, your brother. How could I keep from that? You're the older brother too. We all are. Any time that we look at some other sin and say, well, that's not my sin, it's worse than mine. How could they possibly be so stupid as to do that? We're the older brother. Anytime that someone else has success and celebration, we go, they didn't earn that. We're the older brother. Tell me, what would you do if all the other most churches in town doubled in attendance and we didn't get a single new person here? Would you be happy that God is increasing his kingdom? Or would you sit and pout? Would you be thrilled that there are so many more brothers and sisters that will be joining us in heaven? Or would you be angry? We've got an evening service here. What would you do if the evening service grew to the size of 70, 80 people celebrating and we got no one else in the morning? Would you be thrilled that so many more people are hearing about Jesus? Or would you be angry? Listen, we're the older brother. What a sad thing it is that we are. That we would look at someone else being welcomed by Jesus and saying, well, just because it's not me or because it's not someone I like, I'm not going to like that. Everything you have, everything God has is yours. You are rich beyond measure. Why would we ever begrudge that to someone else? Beloved, become prodigal again. Become prodigal. The older brother has abandoned his father just as much as the younger. He's tried to buy his father's love with what he does. And he can't do it. You cannot buy God's love. He gives it freely. You cannot buy his approval. He gives it freely. You cannot buy his grace. But he pours it out over you. He overflows and pours it all over you. There is a younger son, and there is an older son. But look at the Father. Do you feel his pain? Younger son demands his share of the inheritance, and Father gives it to him. And Father gives him the freedom to do what he wishes with it. And it hurts so much when the younger one walks away. Older brother is trying to buy my love. And Father loses both sons. But do you feel the Father's joy when the prodigal returns? The Father was anxiously watching. He was waiting for his son to return. And when he saw his son in all his filth, Father had compassion on him. He didn't say, I'm going to clean you up first. He didn't say, you gotta prove that you mean it. Father ran to him and embraced him and laughed and wept. This is your Father. Become prodigal again. Smell the stench of your sin and know that you have been washed clean. Jesus has washed you in his own blood and your stench is gone. You are clean. He welcomes you home.
Be used. Reach out.
Again, that league bowling tournament is Saturday, and I never double checked. Do we have prizes lined up for that?
We probably will. We haven't discussed that.
Probably will. Awesome. Okay.
We did last year, so we will this year.
Okay, we did last year, so we will this year. We will do, if we can do that, we'll do a brief meeting about the league bowling tournament after Bible study. We'll keep it brief just to make sure we got our ducks in the row. So if you're involved with the league bowling tournament or you want to be, we'll have a brief meeting at 11:30. And we'll keep it short, like I said, just keeping ducks in a row. Easter is coming, and it is coming fast. You see our schedule here for Holy Week in the bulletin. Every evening service will be at 6:15. I'll get those times there for the next week. We are adding an Easter vigil this year. That is a Saturday night service at 6:15. And what that is, it's almost like a funeral for Jesus. We'll actually gather outside the church, and we will come in all together. It will be relatively dramatic. All of those services are going to be fairly emotional. For instance, Monday, Thursday, we're going to be serving at the altar again, which I know can be very emotional as well. So make plans to be there Holy Week. There's going to be a lot of stuff going on. And as part of Holy Week, usually we decorate the altar with flowers. This year we're doing something a little bit different. I mentioned this last week. Sign up is in the back. We're not just doing lilies, but we're doing all sorts of flowers. Sign up for those flowers is in the back. Please do make note of it. And I've got one more announcement. I got an email this morning. 1 week from today, Charlotte is hosting a Wells Band Festival for about half the nation. They're going to have a lot of high school students there playing together. It's the best of every band of every Wells High School on the east side of the nation. Really cool. A lot of information in the paper. The concert is 2 o'clock a week from today. However, when you get that many people coming from out of town, they need people to house them, and they apparently are desperate and need people to house. If you are interested in housing a high school student or students for Thursday night through Sunday morning, talk to me. I've got papers that details what's all needed on that, so that you can make an informed decision if that's something that you go, oh yeah, I can handle having a high school student in my house for a few days. It does include needing to pick up and drop off at Shoreland, so you do need transportation, or to be able to hook something up. But if you're interested, talk to me. I've got those sheets. I'm happy to share them, and I'll